are more than 9 million hectares of arable sands across the southern cropping region. That leads to constraints to crop production and big gaps between yield potential and actual yields.
We're probably now starting to see things like non-wetting sand spread across the landscape. With continuous cropping, we've got pH changes, and we've also got this naturally hard setting sands, and then you've got compaction with big heavy machinery.
Jock McNeil grows grain, legumes and has breeding ewes. This is not his paddock, he farms a few k's up the road, but he's helping researchers with his knowledge of one of the machines being trialled to tackle sandy soils.
It's just a matter of finding the right machine to either specifically be good at ameliorating one thing or trying to find a machine that can do multiple jobs across the landscape.
This is a big part of what Project Lead, the CSIRO's Therese McBeath, aims to evaluate over the next 3 years. This is the second major sandy soils investment supported by GRDC, the first resulting in grower workshops around the southern region, along with a raft of new information and yield enhancing techniques available on the GRDC website and the Sandbox app.
The Sandy Soils 2 investment has three programs of work. The first program of work is the spatial work, where we're trying to address the question of where to start and stop in the landscape with deep tillage, particularly sandy landscapes.
That means only applying deep tillage where it's needed to increase yield and profit. No more, no less.
The second program of work is where we're trying to look at techniques that sustain and feed the new potential that comes from overcoming constraints to crop production in sandy soil.
So making the most of that hard-fought new soil profile you've achieved with deep tillage.
And then the third program of work tackles the agronomic issues around post-amelioration management, so getting crops established, making sure we have the right fertiliser regimes and crop sequences once we've applied those tillage techniques.
There are 23 large-scale farm-based experiments from Eyre Peninsula to Western Victoria. Chris Saunders at the University of South Australia works with the Agricultural Machinery Research and Design Centre.
We're bringing machinery expertise to the project, so we're all about sort of choosing, using and optimising the machinery.
The machine that grower Jock McNeil is familiar with is a bit of a jack-of-all-trades, set up with a combination of mixing discs, deep ripping tines, levelling discs and tyre press wheels at the back.
I've got other items of equipment myself, but they're only limited to a certain soil type, certain conditions, etc. I think this machine has the possibilities to do multiple soil types, multiple jobs, fix multiple constraints with the right setups.
What we find here is that machine doesn't work quite as deep as a straight deep ripper, but it's getting to a layer where it's reducing some of that physical compaction. And the discs in front are actually mixing some of that surface material, and we'll see how well that is compared to a spader.
The spader doesn't work so well in these mallee soils with limestone beneath the surface, but this slow and steady option definitely has its place.
We found in the past that the spader is really the king for good quality mixing. It's a very slow process, it's quite expensive, but it's really good at mixing the material to its working depth.
Inclusion rippers are the deep tillage implements fitted with inclusion plates bolted behind the ripping tine.
Here at this site, the soil sand is a bit shallower. So in the past, you would have seen our inclusion plates were getting bigger, taller and longer. So when we try and go deep with an inclusion plate, if we have a rock or a layer that we cannot penetrate, we have to reduce the depth of work. If we reduce the depth of work with a large inclusion plate, it'll actually come out of the surface of the soil and stop anything including at all. So in this case, we've had to design and build smaller, shallower inclusion plates that are optimised for the working depth.
So the active discs gather material wide to the side of the tines, and the shallow plate is filled with the surface organic material, which in this case includes canola stubble.
What we have done with our inclusion plates now is gone a little bit longer, because in the past we've shown that the length of the inclusion plate was one of the key factors on getting a high volume of material included into the profile to depth.
And the goal of this project, according to Therese?
Our greatest ambition is to be able to produce maps for growers at the paddock scale, where they can look at that map and know where they're going to apply tillage with confidence in that paddock. that's a very technically challenging thing to do.
No two subsoils are the same, so if there is mapping and we've got a better understanding what's at depth, yeah, hopefully all the money that's getting invested in machinery and diesel and time actually ends in a good result.
Once again, take a look at the fact sheets on the GRDC website for more detailed information on the pros and cons of different machinery and some of the other tools developed for sandy soils.